Welcome Shankara TV viewers and greetings to you all. So we continue that what happens to a weak mind? If the mind is weak, if the mind is replete with negative thoughts and emotions, the mind is at the weakest level. John Hagelin, one of the greatest physicists, says it cannot even lift its own hand. The body cannot lift our own hands. Therefore, the concentration, primary concentration, and the importance should be given to mind even before giving to the body. The mind has to be exercised. That's why people now think of meditations and other mental tools, which we would come to later on. The fundamental idea is to exercise your mind so that it has the ability to drive away negative thoughts. The mind should primarily possess to drive away the negative thoughts so that beautifully the bed is formed and automatically the noble thoughts fall in. If your mind is weak, what can you do? The classic example is that from Bhagavad Gita. Arjuna, you know, was one of the greatest archers, a greatest athlete. He could concentrate on that bird when other peers, his contemporaries, were concentrating, were seeing the branches and the leaves. It was Arjuna, the finest of the archers world had produced at those times, saw only the bird on the branch and struck it with precision through his arrow. That Mahabahu, even Krishna addresses Arjuna as Mahabahu. Krishna says, O Kaunteya, O Arjuna. He respects Arjuna for his skill, and that is why he gets associated with Arjuna, because he knows the powers of Arjuna. But here what happens? On the battlefield, Arjuna's mind gets weak. Arjuna's mind went weak. He dropped his gandipam, he dropped his bow and arrow flat, sat down, refused to get up. The power of the physical body of Arjuna is incomparable. He was an athlete. He was physically well conformed to undertake any battle. He adhered to a fine physical fitness. But at this moment, his mind shattered. His mind became a wave, not a particle. He was so weak that he could not even lift his gandipam, lift his bow and arrows, forget about his fighting a war. But Krishna here performed the role of a psychologist, empowering not his body, not his skill, but his mind. Dronacharya had already empowered him in his skill, but Krishna empowered his mind, because that alone can sustain a battle. That alone, Krishna realized, can win the battle. What did Arjuna say? Arjuna said, Chanchalam me manaha Krishna pramadi balavadridam tasya aham Nigraham manye vayoriva sa dushkaram. Chanchalam me manaha Krishna. I cannot do, my mind is flickering. Pramadi, agitating, balavadridam, certainly and strongly. Chanchalam me manaha Krishna, pramadi balavadridam. Tasya of that, aham, me, I, nigraham, throw it out, manye, in the mind, vayo riva, just like the wind, strong wind, sa dushkaram, it's difficult just like a strong wind, I cannot do anything, I am sorry, I cannot fight, he said. That's what he said to Krishna in Bhagavad Gita, chanchalam me manaha Krishna, pramadi balavadridham, तस्या अहम निग्रह निग्रहम मन्ये वायोरिव स दुष्करम. ओ सॉरी कृष्णा, आई कैनॉट डू. ही सैट डाउन, द आर्मी वॉज देयर, एवरीथिंग वॉज अरेंज्ड. हिज माइंड गॉट ब्रोक. द स्ट्रॉन्ग, द केपेबल आर्चर, द मैन हु नोज हाउ टू यूज हिज बो एंड एरो टू परफेक्शन, द मैन हु कैन शूट डाउन at pinpoint levels accurately, could not raise his own bow and arrow from the ground. He sat down there. Krishna was stunned. Krishna was stunned. He was a psychologist here. He acted. He took the role of a psychiatrist, a psychologist, and started indoctrinating in him positive energies, positive thoughts. Hey Arjuna, what are you doing? You have an unbridled mind, he said. Asamyata, he said. Atmana, by that. Yogaha, even the yoga. Dushprapya iti me matihi. Asamyata means unbridled, unbridled. You have to bridle a horse so that you can have a control on that, so that you can ride a horse. Your mind is like a horse. It is an unbridled mind. With an unbridled atmana, yogaha also, any yogic actions, any actions. Dushprapya iti me matihi, my opinion. Vasya atmana, one which is controllable, one which has been controlled. Vasyam, vasyam means, even in Tamil we use the word, even in Malayalam, even in Hindi, that is controlled. Vasya atmana tu, but vasya atmana, to yatata, while being endeavored, yatata avaptum, to be obtained, upayate. Upayate means while being in the appropriate way, in the appropriate correct way, it can be obtained by a vasya atmana, anything. Shakyaha, he says, it is possible. Yatata shakyaha avaptum upayate. Very beautifully he explains. Only if you, he says, asamyata atmana, atmana, asamyata atmana, yogaha. Yogaha means even the yogic action. Dushprapya iti me matihi. Vasya atmana tu, but, vasya atmana through a controlled mind. Vasya atmana tu, yatata shakyah avaptum upayate. Control your mind as Arjuna. Don't leave it as an uncontrolled mind. Control, just like you bridle a horse. When you want to ride a horse properly, everything is possible. First, when you bridle that horse, you have to put the saddle and the bridle, they call. If you have an unbridled mind, if you are not in control of your mind, you can do nothing. You have to train your mind. You control your mind now. It is not that I am more interested in you, whether you are shooting properly or not, or chanting that mantra to shoot properly or not with your bow and arrow. I am more interested in controlling your mind. Don't have an unbridled mind. What you are weak now is not in your body, but in your spirit. You are not powerful enough in your mind. It is mind that controls your body. And because of your weak mind, your physical powerful body becomes weak. You have become weak. What is it that you are going to achieve? Strengthen your mind. Krishna gives a very, very proper treatment at that point to Arjuna, and that treatment was the treatment of the mind, not the treatment of any skill, not a battle planning strategy, not the way to attack, not how to use the bow and arrow, not which mantra you have to chant at what times, not which arrow to use or not which bow to use, or not how to shoot, where to shoot, when to shoot, sitting or standing, how to shoot your, fling your arrows and bows or your swords. Krishna gave only one simple treatment to Arjuna at that point, and the rest became history in Mahabharata. That treatment was treatment of the mind, the way of indoctrinating and injecting positive thoughts into the mind of Arjuna that again made him stand and fight and bring and create history. So what is the motive here? What is it I want to express upon you? Is the treatment of your mind is important. As much as you give importance to your body, as much as you jog, you take your medicines for your body, kindly take medicines for your mind. Kindly know what your thoughts are. That is what again I am again telling you of the Rig Veda. Why Rig Veda? Again in Atharvana Mandukya Upanishad, what does the Rishi say? Badram karnebihi shrunuyama deva. You see nobility everywhere, noble thoughts, positive thoughts everywhere. Karnebihi, by your ears. Badram pashyema akshibihi yajatra. What is deserving to be adored to be seen? Yajatra. Akshibihi means by your eyes. That should be badram karne, badram pashyema. You have to see only those noble thoughts, only those noble things, so that it pours noble thoughts in you. You have to hear something noble so that your mind is filled with something noble. Everywhere in the Vedas they talk of nobility. They talk of positive thoughts only, because it is mind that is going to control you. And then comes your body. Very beautifully expressed. This one has to understand. If you always think negative thoughts, if you, I cannot fight, Arjuna puts his bow and arrow. I am sorry, I am weak. I am not able to stand. If you develop such negative thoughts, what happens? Somebody like Krishna has to come to clear away those negative thoughts, and you have to access a greater help than you yourself can do. Luckily, Arjuna had Krishna, but we do not know how many of us have that Krishna. World had people like this. You see, I was studying a subject in economics called the theory of population by Dr. Robert Malthus, Malthusian theory of population, it is known as. It is totally negative. A classic book on a negative area written by a very great economist, but I call him as a negative economist. Now, he says the population increases in geometric progression, whereas food production increases only in arithmetic progression. Now, C is negativity. How he has come to the conclusion that population increases in geometric progression and food production increases only in arithmetic progression? Where was his calculation? And therefore, he says, thereby the entire world will face famine, death. He says diseases also, because of lower food production. Because of lower food production, there is going to be famine. He declares, he writes, because the production of food is not commensurate with the increase, the growth rate of increase in the population, the human population, the human beings, the world population. Now, in what way he has assessed, I do not know. There was no scientific basis. But except he had conjectured this idea only by his own negative thoughts and spewed out, injected his negative poison to the world. I will never accept this theory at all. What happened to his theory? It got rejected. Norman Borlaug, the famous Brazilian scientist who is also called the father of the agricultural revolution, brought out revolution in agricultural production. More quantity, tonnage per hectare was achieved through science and technology that could feed millions and millions of people more throughout the world. Our own Dr. M.S. Swaminathan also did this agricultural revolution in India, when the acreage, when the tonnage per acre increased manifold. So, population had increased maybe, but did we face a famine? There are sufficient food grains all over the world. 80 million tons of food grain are stored by the Food Corporation of India, and they are being eaten away mostly by rodents and rats, because there is no consumption. There is an excess production for a very high population. We are now 125 crores, 1.25 billion, about 15-16% of the world's population of around 7 billion, 700 crores. We are 125. So the government has to give subsidy to the farmers and buy that food grains from them, paying them higher price and storing them in the godowns, in the warehouses of FCI. Why should this happen? What I am telling you is, it is the positive brilliance of Dr. Norman Borlaug or Dr. M. S. Swaminathan that has brought this revolution. They never cried and booed like Robert Malthus, writing all those funny theories, funny negative theories, which only speaks calamity, apocalypse of the society, destruction of the society, warning the society of some danger which would never happen. These types of negative writings does dampen the growth rates, dampen our enthusiasm. It does not give a positive thinking, it does not give a positive outlook, a rosy outlook. At least give a rosy outlook, whether you achieve it or not. Hitch your wagon to a star. Hitch your wagon to a star, Jawaharlal Nehru said. Think high. Think very big. Never mind about any impending thoughts or negative thoughts, whether you can achieve or not. Wright brothers thought that they have to fly like a bird in the sky, and they created the plane. Whether we can create a plane or not was not their issue. They wanted to create, they created. I came, I saw, I conquered. That was the positive thought they had in them. Why I am telling you all these things is, people will talk negatively. Their job is to talk negatively. They are all satsters. They always talk something which is negative, something which may not happen. They will warn you of the dangers, but they do not know that there is something called technology, the sixth sense. There are more positive people. There are people who are very positive, who can surpass, overcome such negative results and thoughts. So Malthusian theory was defeated primarily, totally, and has got zero value in today's common parlance and application. It has absolutely no value whatsoever. Why? Because of the positive thoughts that came into the minds of Dr. Norman Borlaug and Dr. M. S. Swaminathan, things changed. Things changed for the good of the world. So what I am essentially telling is, it is up to you to culture your own positive thoughts. You don't allow those negative thoughts to step in at all. They are not your nature. The nature, the temperature of a water is warm, it's nice. You heat it, it will get boiled. You cool it, it will get frozen. But what is its nature? Its nature is calm. Your mind is calm, your mind is full of nobility. If you start planting weeds, allowing, opening your conscious mind and allowing all these negative thoughts right from your infancy stage, as you grow, you will have only bushes and weeds in your mind. And even if you want to cultivate that land and make it fertile and have a good crop, the task will be difficult for you, because first you have to weed out those weeds, cull out those weeds, throw them away, and then you have to till your land, then fertilize it, then plant the seeds, water, and as and when weeds sprout, you have to again and again clean them up. Your mind is exactly the same. If you start paying attention to your mind, if you have the inherent attraction towards your mind that it would only breed positive thoughts, If you forget all those negative thoughts, then what happens? Your mind is blissful. It will have the power to create an universe. When an infinite dot can create an universe, why not your mind containing several infinite dots? When a cubic centimeter can have 10 to the power of 94 grams of energy, several million times or billion times more than the mass of this universe, why can't your mind? Why can't you, when you yourself is a part in the force of this cosmos, then the cosmic forces, when cosmic energy has an infinite power, why can't you also, being a part of an infinite, have that infinite power? The world of infinity is different. Purnamada Purnam, whatever you want to do with Purnam, the infinite one, you cannot do, because it is infinite, is infinite. You have, we, humanity, caught that infinite power with our negative emotions. It smokes. We smoke completely, cloud it, or it gets clouded totally, thick coatings form from that infinite power. So we are not able to clean the infinite, we are not able to clean the emotions. So the power gets mugged. It gets mugged by all those smoke and dirt and black sulfur. So that should not happen. For that, you have to train your mind. We have to bring that sort of a training the mind attitude first, right from the stage of infancy. Though most of us have crossed that stage, we can try to apply that power, that this science, to our children, grandchildren or great-grandchildren, and then preach this power to everyone so that they propagate this. It becomes a science. I will tell you some of the aspects of how this negative energy gets in, aspects, and also some ways how they get into it, get into our system, and how they pollute our system. And then we shall see how to promote positive thinking. See, as I told you earlier, anger is one of the worst negative thought that can come into human mind, which I have explained to you clearly. Bhagavan's verse also I have given to you. Thiruvalluvar's verse also I have given to you. This anger also creates us a distorted communication system in us. As I told you, you have not studied well. You have failed. If you don't go to the office, you will get dismissed. You are not eating properly. You are coming always late. You are not paying any attention. This not paying attention, not having money, not having positive outlook, not having petrol in the car. Even you, they will say that there is no petrol in the car. See, these things can be changed a little bit. Instead of saying you don't have a petrol in the car, say you will have to refill the petrol tank. Instead of telling that boy you will fail if you don't study, tell the boy that if you study, you will come, you will earn the first rank in the class. If you go on time to the office, you will be the promoted. Don't tell, if you do not go to the office on time, you will get dismissed. You will not get promotion. Why you should say you will not get promotion? Tell, if you go on time, you will get promotion. If you eat well, you will be strong. If you cross the road applying your mind, you will reach safely. People would say, if you cross the road without looking here and there, some scooter will come and knock you down. See, these are negative energies with which parents or elders like us or others talk, and they build up that field. They build up the field of those weeds. There are a certain set of communication systems which you have to adopt. And once you start adopting these systems, then what you are doing is, you are creating a field of positive thoughts. The magnetic field becomes positive. The field around you, so you attract. Just like a clean road attracts cleanness, cleanliness everywhere, and a dirty road attracts only rubbish. People will start throwing more and more garbage there. A very clean mind, a soft mind, a spongy mind, becomes so beautiful, so that if you conform yourself to addressing others with proper words, what happens is only the beautiful, pristine, pure negative thoughts will flow into your memory, will flow into your brain like that beautiful, pure river flowing into your brain. Your thoughts, you as a person gets development. As a person, you develop, you develop, you develop. And in that process, what happens is others also develop. You are seeing others developing because of you. Because of the change in yourself, others also developed towards positivity. Everywhere you will find that law of attraction. People will get attracted. The thoughts get ricocheted. Thank you, viewers. So more of this we shall see in the next episode. Till such time, thank you all.